You're listening to the Raw Honeys Podcast, the place to be real, be love, and be friend. Join Chelsea Fine, Heather Hildenbrand, and me, Amanda Axel. We're real friends who aren't afraid to talk about the raw truth of real life. If you're looking for a group of girlfriends who will support and encourage you when the going gets tough, this is the place to be. Pull up a chair, grab a cup of coffee, or a glass of wine, and enjoy the show.
Hello, honeys. Thank you for joining today's show. This is Chelsea Fine, and I'm here with Heather Hildenbrand and Amanda Axel. And today we're going to be talking about the importance of self-care. In the hustle and bustle of today's world, taking care of yourself is often the last thing on anyone's to-do list. Yet it plays a vital role in our overall life performance and satisfaction. So why is it so hard for us to do something that's so important? Phrases like self-care or self-love are often misunderstood as being something selfish or weak. But is that the case? What exactly is self-care, and why is it so hard to practice? These are just a few of the things we want to tackle in today's episode, so let's get right into it. I'm going to start with Heather. Heather, what do you see self-care as? Like, how would you define self-care?
I think for me, self-care is an action. It's, a habit or an action that I take that makes me either feel good or feel better or de-stress or eliminate stress before it starts. Just something that means something to me that settles or grounds me. And at the same time, you know, is like a testament to that I think I'm important. So for me, self-care is an action. It's a thing that I'm doing for myself in my day.
Yeah. What about you, Amanda? What's self-care to you?
To me, self-care is a necessity. And to me, it's no different than brushing your teeth or washing your body or eating, you know, healthy foods, drinking lots of water. Some of these actually are self-care practices, by the way.
Yeah.
But yeah, I definitely think it's something vital, not just for women, but for all people to take part in.
Yeah,
absolutely.
What about you, Chelsea?
I would say the same as the two of you for sure, self-care. I think personally, you know, a definition that I've already always sort of carried is something I'm doing for my benefit alone, kind of. Like no one else is going to benefit from it. Not that that's like a prerequisite, but just something I'm doing that benefits me directly and kind of only me. And a lot of times I put like things that are pleasurable in that category, you know, like doing a puzzle. Sometimes it's self-care for me. I love to do puzzles, like jigsaw puzzles. Like I love them. But yeah, so I would probably define it the same way as you guys. Which is kind of important because I think there's a lot of people out there who maybe don't fully understand what self-care means, or maybe they think of it as being something that is selfish or perhaps even weak. You know, like something like, what is self-care? Oh, that's putting yourself before others. And maybe that's what we should talk about a little bit today, too, is like, do we think that self-care is something selfish? And if not, Why is there this misconception that it could be? Because if we want to promote something positive, like self-care, we're going to have to get over that hump first of the perception. So what do you think? What do you think, Amanda?
You know, it's funny because while you were talking about self-care as a benefit to yourself, and that's sort of the marker of a true self-care practice, like maybe doing a puzzle, like, oh, I'm the only one benefiting from me doing this puzzle right now. But I think that that's actually not true. Not to contradict you, but hear me out, because this is exactly what we're talking about. Is self-care selfish or is it selfless? And I think that, yeah, at first glance, you doing a puzzle, of course, is like maybe considered a selfish thing, or maybe it's just for you or whatever. But what is the result of you taking some time to sit quietly and work some things out while you're doing a puzzle or doing it just for pure pleasure? Like, what is the result of that? Maybe you become more centered. Maybe your patience gets replenished, you know, maybe you feel lighter. And so the way you talk to your children or your spouse is completely different if you hadn't done that puzzle. So I think that anything we do for ourselves, it is not just for ourselves. If it makes us feel good and helps us to show up as a better version of ourselves, then it is totally a selfless act.
Yeah,
I totally agree, but I didn't realize that until, or I didn't either, I can say realize that, or I can say change my belief about that until I really made self-care a priority in my life. Because before that, I felt like, I know a lot of women feel like, and that is that you have to be everything to everybody and you come last. And until I stopped operating that way, when I stopped operating that way and I started doing things for myself, slowly I started to see that Amanda's right, that the people around me were benefiting from the care I was taking with myself, from improved patience to just a good life example. Because for me as a mom, you know, we're all about self-sacrifice, right? I mean, it comes naturally after you birth a baby. It's just boom, that's what you're doing. And you're giving up things so that your kids don't, or taking care of people when you don't feel like it or whatever. And I mean, obviously what we're not saying here is we're not saying never take care of your children so that you can put yourself first. That's not what we're saying. But when I have to make a choice, a hard choice, and I'm like, you know, I don't know what the right thing here is. A lot of times now what I'll ask myself is, what is the example I'm setting for my kids with whichever choice I'm making here? So, and that clarifies it a lot for me. And I say that because if you're a mom and you're listening, or if you're a spouse and you're listening, you know, if you have other people in your life counting on you that you sort of do find yourself self-sacrificing for or taking care of before yourself, ever. And a lot of times it's family. We end up being a caregiver for people in our family. You know, if you've made this commitment to be there for somebody or to be in a partnership role or a caregiver role, you're going to do things you don't want to do for people or do things when you don't feel like it for people. But you know, when you hit that wall where you go, okay, I just reached my limit. And that's when you have the choice and you can decide, okay, am I going to do this next thing, which is basically gonna, you know, burn me out or flip me out or, you know, make me bitter or whatever, you know, that one last thing that's gonna push you over the edge? Or are you gonna do something, take a break, do something for yourself, or just say no? I mean, saying no is a huge self-care thing for me as somebody who does take care of a lot of people. And sometimes just that simple act is enough for me to go, it just like reaffirms like, oh yeah, I matter too. And so it's not really for me about putting myself over others in terms of like never taking care of their needs or never caring about their needs. It's really just equally caring about my own.
Yeah.
And making sure that I remember that I also matter just as much as they do in that daily equation.
Absolutely.
So. And Chels, I know you agree because you have kids and you have a big family, yeah. A big family that you take care of. You take care of so many people, your brothers and sisters and a lot of people.
Yeah. Well, and I think kind of no matter how many people or how big or small your plate is, the caring of others, no matter what that means or looks like in your life is it's an honor, but it's an exhausting honor. It's taxing. It takes something from you, and it should, because that's what giving is. But there are repercussions for that. We get worn down and we can get weary and stuff like that. And so absolutely being able to consider yourself an equal to the others, those other loved ones in your life, and to put your needs on the same level as theirs is like, what an accomplishment. Actually, I think that that's actually kind of very hard for a lot of, well, I'm going to say a lot of women, probably specifically American women, a lot of moms, it's very hard to do. I know for me, even when I get to a place where I am like, okay, I am going to take some time for myself, or I am going to give myself this thing that I need right now, I struggle doing those things without guilt. even when I do them, if that makes sense. Like even when I take that step of, well, I'm going to call it bravery, and I'm like, no, I need a moment for me, or I need to take a really extra long shower today because I need some silence. I struggled being able to take those moments or those very small asks for myself without feeling guilty. And a lot of that guilt, I've realized just in the recent years, I actually put on myself. There is a conditioning that's put on us by our culture, by our society, perhaps even by our family members. But a lot of it is almost so habitual for me that I'm just like, I'm preemptively assuming that everyone's going to be angry with me if I take a shower longer than 2 minutes. So it's just like this weird cycle I find myself in of guilt. And then the guilt sometimes leads to me not wanting to take that. What are you thinking, Amanda?
Well, I'm sorry, my voice keeps going out today. I don't know what's happening, but but what you just said,
sexy.
Yeah, oh, thank you. No, what you were just talking about, you know, really made me think about gender roles and gender roles in our society, and how even how we, you know, as women perpetuate these same roles. And I think traditionally in the American sense, oh my goodness, what is going on with my voice?
I hope you didn't get that from me, because I'm getting over being sick and it keeps happening to me, but I'm good right now. So I might have passed my froggy throat on to you.
Going around.
I don't know where I got it from. I don't think I got it from you, considering I'm like 1500 miles from you.
Maybe it's a Texas thing. I don't know.
It definitely could be. But yeah, I mean, I think, you know, traditionally, you know, at least in more modern culture, women are considered to be the backbone of the family, in the sense that we are the emotional support, the physical support, the mental support, and the spiritual support of the entire family. All of it falls because we are so nurturing, right? Like our nurturing is such a benefit, but it can also backfire on us if we let people take advantage of it, which we do because that's what we were taught to do. That we should sacrifice everything. We should sacrifice our health and our self-care and all of these things. So, because here's the question is, do you think men feel guilty when they go to a game to refresh themselves,
oh,
or, you know, when they go to the gym, or, you know, or whatever, fill in the blank, you know what I mean?
Or when they say no, or when they don't do a chore, right. Which is like,
or when they put one off,
all the time.
You know, yeah, exactly. Yeah. Do they feel any guilt?
No.
I don't know. Probably not.
No. Well, I'm speaking with one man in mind anyway. Sorry to call you out, Dylan, but no, I know for a fact he doesn't. Actually, that's one of the things I admire about him. I know we're talking about how it's not fair in these gender roles, and it's not, but I admire that in general, he doesn't really carry guilt. And I want less of what I carry. So I'm like, tell me how you, you know, and I admire that, because I want to be more like that for that reason, because guilt isn't productive, and because it's not fair and it's not useful. And so, yeah, I agree with you though, that it is a gender thing. Guys don't feel bad about that stuff. No.
Certainly not as bad as women do. I mean, if we take history as any example, It's definitely something that I find that men have a hard time empathizing with, for sure. Like even something very small, like sleeping in my household, you know, when you have kids and stuff, the ability to be the parent that can sleep in on a day when, you know, when you have little kids that are going to wake up and stuff, like that's kind of my barometer.
Oh, yeah.
Like if I feel comfortable asking, like, hey, do you think you could wake up at 5 a.m.?
Oh, my God. So.
And I can sleep in.
That reminds me. I just saw this meme on Instagram on the mom account that I follow, which they're hilarious. I follow a couple because they're so funny. And because they're true. Because the one they just posted was like, it's this conversation between husband and wife. And the husband, they're laying in bed. And the husband's like, let's do something different tonight. And the wife is like, oh, so I get to sleep 8 hours straight and you're going to wake up with the kids all night. Cool. Yeah. Let's do something different tonight.
Let's change it up. Yeah.
She's like, that turns me on. You know, it's like, yeah, really. I mean, listen, we're not bashing men. There are lots of men that are helpful, but I will say that there is this assigned mentality, and women perpetuate it to each other, which just saddens me even more, to like be quote unquote perfect, to do all the things. And when it wears them down, they almost wear their exhaustion like this badge of honor, which makes me double sad because that should not be evidence, you know, negative evidence of what you're putting yourself through should not be your finish line, your goal, you know, like there's no trophy for that, guys. So it really does. It frustrated me and in my own life. I think I got to the point where I realized that's not how I wanted to live my whole life. And so I don't know. I don't really know what changed. It was just like a bunch of things that added up, and then finally I was like, okay, I'm gonna choose me sometimes. And it was hard at first because I had that same kind of guilt. And so one thing I just always ask myself is like, what example are you setting right now if you choose X over Y? And especially because I have a daughter, and I don't want my daughter to grow up and get married and then self-sacrifice to the point where she, you know, makes herself sick or whatever because she's never taken care of herself because that's what she saw me do. Nobody wants that for our kids. You know, nobody wants to
No,
leave
of course
that
not.
example for people. And when I frame it like that, I'm like, oh, okay, cool. She needs to see me telling her ass no right now. So that's what I do.
Yeah, it's a lot about the legacy that we're leaving. I mean, every decision that we make as parents, but just as humans, as influencers of anybody else, even remotely close to us, like it's important, you know, it leaves a legacy of some kind. And I do think that sadly, I think a big obstacle for a lot of people when it comes to practicing self-care has to do with that. Maybe like that, the misunderstanding or the stigma kind of associated with it that has to do with being selfish, like we were talking about a moment ago. And so I was just like sitting here thinking, okay, so how can we make people feel safer about it? Like, where is that fine line where self-care turns into selfishness or vice versa? Like, how can people, I don't know, and I don't have the answer to this, but I'm just thinking to myself, I know that trying to practice self-care can sometimes be daunting if you view self-care as an act of selfishness. And so maybe in an attempt to kind of shake that habit, like what are some really safe self-care maybe tactics or lifestyle choices or just little thingamajiggas we could like offer up to people as far as like try this out and see if this like impacts you in a positive way. You know, can you guys think of anything like that?
Oh, I know Amanda can. Amanda's so good at
Well,
it.
I also don't have kids, so it
It
might be a
doesn't matter.
solution
You are
either.
good at knowing what your body
Seriously,
needs.
you're so good at it.
Well, thank you guys. And first of all, I love that Chelsea said thingamajiggas. That was awesome.
Me too.
So
I love that
add
she
that to
said
your
it all
vocabulary,
gangster.
honeys. No. I loved it. I loved it. No, I mean, okay, so this is for me, this is a two-part thing. So first is I love what Chelsea was saying there at the end. Like, what can we try? Like, how can we kind of try this out? And I think that's the thing is we're all intelligent people, right? And if we can show evidence to support that self-care is actually not selfish, but it actually can be very selfless, a selfless practice or act. Then that's what we should do. And something I like that I think feels like non-threatening and a little non, you know, committed and all these things is put on your white lab coat in, you know, not literally unless you have one and go for it, but just to experiment. Say, you know what, I'm really exhausted and I would just really love to sleep for 9 hours for a few nights or take a bath or get out of town for a couple of days or whatever it is that you feel like you might need, and just record the results, just like an experiment, and see, oh, was I better at my job because I took some time off? Or was I a better wife because, you know, I got to finally shave my legs for once or whatever, you know what I mean? Or get a pedicure or whatever, you know what I mean? Like, whatever it is. And just see what the results are and record them. Like, you guys literally record them. Don't just in your mind, like mentally say, okay, that was effective or it wasn't. And the reason I say that is because if you do something like that, you may very well fall off this track of self-care. And when you do, you're going to need those notes to remind you. You're going to need that substantial evidence from yourself recorded saying, oh yeah, I forgot about that. This goes back to my personal notes thing, which I totally believe in. So please.
I was wondering if you were going to say anything about this. She literally means record your voice to yourself.
Yep.
Yeah. Yes. Well, yes, I'm talking about written results, but absolutely. I think recording your voice is super powerful, or even record a video on your phone. It's so easy now to record footage of yourself.
It just feels weird, but because that's why I didn't do it, because it felt weird to think, oh, I'm going to record a message to myself. Okay. Which shouldn't be weird because we all talk to ourselves. But when I heard yours and I realized it wasn't just the things you were saying to yourself, it was your tone of voice and everything. You can hear how refreshed you sounded. Like, I made Amanda send me her voice notes to herself because I haven't recorded mine yet. So I'm like, can I just listen to yours? Because you sound amazing right now.
I know. And yes, because you want, because who better to trust than yourself? You know
totally.
What I mean? Like, if you literally experience it in your own life, can't you take your own word for it?
Yeah. Well, and who better to trust than your best self, really? Because when you're at your high after you've done self-care and you're feeling good, like, yeah, you will trust, like, oh yeah, because when I'm in it, I can't remember all the things I should be doing. I can't remember. I can't get the motivation to do the things that'll get me out of it. So hearing myself tell myself, oh yeah, when you did this, you felt amazing. I would be like, well, she sounds like believable. I'm going to do it, you know?
She sounds like she knows what she's talking about.
Yeah, right? And I don't think I do right now, so I'm going to believe her, which is me,
right,
and do it.
Well, that is because it's coming from a version of you that has an elevated life condition, basically, that has a high life condition. And one of the ways to cultivate that is to do those things that refresh your soul and refresh your body and your mind and your spirit. And that can look like a bunch of different things. I think we could create a list, and, you know, some people would take, you know, a little bit from column A, others would take from column B, you know what I mean? Like, you kind of have to create your own, and it's just by becoming very self-aware. Pay attention to the things that you do that you feel refreshed afterwards or that light you up. Like, for me, I love watching Grey's Anatomy with a cup of tea or coffee, you know, on a Saturday morning. That shit gets me going. Okay. Like, I feel like all the crap I went through the entire week was totally fine at that
moment.
It was
worth it.
You know? It was worth it because I got to reward myself with this, you know, 45 minute time just to myself. And I, you know, I get to see things and feel things and relax and whatever. You know, or, you know, actually for me, having conversations with my friends is like something that really helps me. Yeah. And that's why Heather and I used to talk on the phone
every day. Yeah.
And it was at a period in our life where we actually were putting self-care as the top priority of our life.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And so no wonder we were able to.
We really were. And what's so funny, and we say this all the time too, is like our professional output wasn't any less though. That was back when I was writing a book a month and publishing like a book every 45 days or something like that. Crazy. And I didn't feel like it was hard, but that's because I was so creative and like flowing and in it. And I was only feeling like that because my self-care well was totally full. So
yep.
Yeah, it affects everything. It's really cool.
It is. Well, that's what makes it so important. I mean, anything that affects everything should always be a priority. And I think that that's what makes it so heartbreaking when we do feel like we can't give ourselves self-care, or when we don't feel like we have permission to at least even experiment with what could be self-care for us and something we need. And mm-hmm. And as far as the selfishness aspect of things go, I would say that pretty much doing anything that's healthy for you that does not negatively affect anything else in your life, that's okay. That's not a selfish act. That's kind of where I kind of draw my parameters.
I will say though that for a lot of women, I think, because a lot of women I talk to, and this was me, that when you're just trying to break out of this, like, I don't know what to call it, this martyrdom that you're self-sacrificing and you're never putting yourself first. Mm. When you start that, it does feel like it negatively impacts other people. I do hear women that are like, oh. They'll be so mad at me. They get, you know, I can't tell them no. They ask me for something. I have to get up and do it because if I don't, they're so, so mad. And they, you know, like maybe don't treat you well or manipulate you or whatever. And I really, really want to encourage, if you're in that space, just learn to be okay with people being mad at you. That's healthy. People being mad at you. Okay. And I will say it like this, because when the way I grew up put me into a mindset of a person that when I got married, by the time I got married and I had a husband and I had a dysfunctional family situation still going on, that my self-sacrifice had slipped easily into codependence. And codependence is that spot where you won't say no because you fear their reaction, their negative reaction. It's beyond manipulation. It's the way of life in relationships. And that's how it was for sure with my family. And it's how I started operating in my marriage and with my kids too. And that is so, so unhealthy. And it's a totally different topic that you should definitely talk to a licensed therapist about, because I did. And that is one of the only ways I think that you can break free of something like that, because there's so many more layers added to the whole, I have to do all of those things for them and I can't rock the boat. You have to. That's like the only way to break free of that, is you have to rock the boat and you have to just accept that there are going to be negative reactions and they are designed to manipulate you into not choosing yourself ever. They need you to choose them all the time in order to feel better about themselves. And you doing that is not doing them any favors either, but it's not easy. It's really hard. And it feels kind of painful, even though you are doing things to take care of yourself in that space. It's very difficult. And it's not like, you know, like they say, like if you do something so many times, it creates a habit. You have to do it at least 3 to 4 times more often to then make it a habit, because you're breaking out of something that you were so rooted in, that for me was like, that was how I grew up. That was my whole life. And a lot of my family is still rooted in that codependency and still tries to pull me in with trying to get certain reactions. You know, there are things that they're never spoken out loud, but they're expectations that, you know, are placed on you, that like, don't ever bring up anything hard and don't ever talk about, you know, like there are just a lot of parameters and you know where they are and where you fit and what is expected. And it's really easy to get sucked back into something like that. But that is the opposite of self-care. That is toxic. And so anytime you can't, so for me, self-care was learning to be okay with people being mad at me. And I'm still learning that. Still with my extended family, when I try to interact with them as the person I am now, they don't understand. And then it creates conflict. And it's really, really tempting for me to get like wrapped up in like what they think of me. And that is then tempting to like just behave the way they want me to behave to keep the peace or whatever. But I don't, and I had to learn, I'm still learning to be okay with them being mad at me, because part of it is because they don't understand. Part of it is because they think that if they get mad at me, then it'll manipulate me into behaving the way they want me to, or just making it easy on them or whatever, you know? And so so for me, self-care was learning to tell people no. And then like,
yeah,
period, stop, just no, don't explain why, just I'm not going to do that or be that for you. And I think for a lot of women who get sucked in hard to that cycle and it becomes that unhealthy, self-care starts with learning to tell people no, so that then you're telling yourself yes.
That's a really good point, a really great distinction about what self-care, what that definition actually encompasses. Because there are several aspects to self-care. There's the physical aspect, which would be like the things that are more, you know, like the warm cup of tea in the morning, or I like to wake up with a blanket on the couch, stuff like that. And then there are the more emotional and psychological aspects of self-care, which come down to drawing those boundaries, like you were talking about, and learning how to say no to things that are asking more of you than you can give or should give. Absolutely. I think that's a really important, really fragile like element of self-care in general, and actually probably one that we don't talk about on purpose, we as like a culture and a society, because there are some tender points there, just like you mentioned, like yeah. Sometimes we think that saying no and bringing on like the wrath of others, or maybe we want to construe it as the disappointment of others, like yeah, sometimes we want to see that as maybe being a negative effect because we want to please. It's, I mean, we have good intentions, right? But
right.
We can't really be our best selves when we are allowing other people to overstep, you know, into our emotional planes and our psychological planes and stuff like that. Absolutely. I think that's a really great point, Heather, as far yeah. as the different kinds of self-care. Absolutely. Oh my goodness.
And I will say, because we keep throwing around, is it selfish? And I wanted to say about that, that one of the major things that helped me change, because I had to, you know, it's like a whole shifting of belief where you give yourself permission to make yourself just as important as everybody else. And it's hard and it's big. It's not, it's a big thing we're talking about here. And so one of the things I did that really helped me shift that is that I encourage you to either remove the word selfish from your vocabulary, if that's easier, or reframe what that word means. Because I actually hate that that word has a negative connotation. I think the word selfish means that you're about yourself. And there is nothing wrong with that. Why do we give it a negative meaning? Why have we assigned that and then can use it to manipulate somebody? Because that's what it is. You tell somebody they're being selfish, all you're saying is I'm mad at you for not being what I need you to be in order for me to feel good. Like
sometimes, yes, sometimes.
That's what I feel like when people use it as,
sometimes people are being selfish.
Well, when people, yes. When you're trying to do self-care,
oh,
and,
yes,
you know, maybe drawing a boundary and right. When it comes to self-care and you really are just making your needs at least, you know, just equal to other people's, not even higher than or whatever. And that word is tossed around a lot. Like, is it selfish to do self-care? That question rubs at me now because the word selfish doesn't mean to me what it used to mean. And that's good for me. That freed me up to go, okay, they can't use that word against me anymore in a way that makes me, or maybe would used to make me like shrink back from choosing myself. So that was really helpful to reframe that, you know, for me.
For sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I just want to add on to that, if that's okay, is with what Heather was saying is we teach others how to treat us.
Yeah.
And that's just not, yeah. you know, in this regard, but in every way. So I love Heather's analogy about rocking the boat, and it's okay. You probably won't tip it over, but if you do, maybe that's what needs to happen. So you can build a new boat where, you know, people respect you more and they respect your time and your self-care exactly the way that you respect theirs. And I think something else that came up for me in this conversation was the idea of balance, right? Like, you know, we want to have balance, you know, a little for me, a little for you. But I actually don't really love the term balance anymore because I think it makes you think of like what's equitable and what's fair. You know what I mean? And I think the more appropriate term is harmony, you know, because,
ooh, yeah.
you know, you're balancing, right? Like it's a moving thing. It's not a static thing. So you have to ask yourself, is my life in general in harmony? And if it's not, maybe what's needed is self-care. And if you are being a totally selfless or selfish jerk, then maybe what's needed is to give a little, you know what I mean? So like, cause when we do those and they work together, sometimes we're going to need more of one and less of the other and vice versa. But as long as there is like this feeling of harmony within your own life, then, you know, that's really, to me, that's really the marker of, you know, how much self-care do we really need, you know, yeah. or like, are we taking care of ourselves when our life is out of balance or out of harmony? Then we
well,
know.
And are we taking care of other people as much as we should? Because like Chelsea said, sometimes they are. Someone is actually being selfish when that, and then that word is appropriate. And so I love what you just said, Amanda. That was brilliant because there needs to be that harmony or that balance between, and that's why I love, like we're saying, like put your needs equal to everyone else's. So you're not more important than, but you're not less important than. So you are caring about everybody else as much as you're caring about yourself, and you're caring about yourself as much as you're caring about everybody else. And I think when you have both of those in alignment, that is when You have harmony. Totally.
Absolutely. And that's what we're going for in everyday life, right? We're just looking for some harmony. That's where we're all trying to achieve the same thing. And it takes one person at a time to get us there, right? It's a little bit of harmony.
Yeah.
Okay. So we've covered a lot as far as self-care, kind of talked about what the definition of self-care can be and why self-care is not a selfish act or has selfish intentions. So maybe as we're wrapping up today, let's leave our listeners with a little something from each of us. So a little takeaway from self-care. We'll start with Amanda.
Yeah, I would just say, again, put on your lab coat and experiment if this is something that you're challenging in your life. Just try it out. And if you want to be, you know, extra considerate about it, let your family know what you're trying to do. Just say, hey, you know what? I think I could actually be better for you if I did a couple of these things. So this is what I'm going to do, you know? And if they don't like it, well, then just like Heather said, rock the boat a little bit and teach them to respect your ideas and your thoughts and what you need because you respect theirs. And then, you know, if that's not something you're struggling with, if you're like, man, yeah, I don't really have any guilt. I just don't really prioritize myself because maybe I'm prioritizing work or, you know, something else. Then, you know, I would just say, put yourself at the top of the list and see what happens.
Absolutely. What about you, Heather?
Yeah, I love that. I love what you said. Put yourself at the top of the list. I think it's said so often that it's just become cliche and maybe it's overused, but I still love the example of, you know, when you're on an airplane, whose oxygen mask should you put on first? And that's exactly what this comes down to is obviously yours. You should be at the top of the list. And when you do that, it does have a trickle down effect into everything else. And when you don't, it has a trickle down effect into everything else. And if you need any more convincing, because you are a self-sacrificer, maybe a martyr, possibly even in a codependent relationship, ask yourself what you want your kids to see, or what kind of example do you want to show to the people who are watching you? Because when it's hard to do something, we feel like, you know, we're doing it for ourselves. It's hard to do something for ourselves, but we will do it in a heartbeat for the people that we love. Mm-hmm. And so just decide that really you're doing this for them too. And hopefully that will give you the courage and the permission that you need to do it.
Absolutely. And I think I just want to leave our listeners out there with the knowledge that you're not alone. If you are somebody who falls into this category of giving and giving and giving all the time, we see you, we appreciate you, we honor you, we respect the sacrifice that you have given for the loved ones in your life. We are not trying to diminish that at all. It is beautiful. We are just also saying that you are worth a few minutes for yourself. Self-care belongs to you and it belongs to each one of us. And you should not be afraid to claim it or experiment with it. And you should definitely, definitely try to pursue it. It belongs in your life. It will only make you healthier and it will only allow you to give more to the people that you love. So take care of yourselves, honeys. You all deserve it so much. And we will see you guys next time on The Raw Honeys.
We hope you enjoyed today's episode of The Raw Honeys podcast. If so, please share it with a friend or post a review. Heather, Chelsea, and I would love to connect with you. Check us out on Instagram, at The Raw Honeys, or join our community of honeys on Facebook. Thanks for listening. We wish you nothing but big love.